Hello, welcome to an in-depth review of Mirror's Edge, a 2008 game developed by DICE and published by EA. Now this is an in-depth review, I'm going to be discussing the game in detail from beginning, middle to end, so beware, there will be story spoilers. Mirror's Edge is probably one of the most divisive games of its generation. People seem to either love it or hate it, or they just never played it. Nevertheless, it's garnered quite a loyal cult following, big enough that EA have got a sequel in development, despite the fact the original didn't exactly set the world on fire in terms of sales. So why do some people love Mirror's Edge, and why do some people hate it? What could have been done better? Let's drop its trousers and give Mirror's Edge a good thorough examination.
Once the city used to pulse with energy. Dirty and dangerous, but alive and wonderful. Now, it's something else. The changes came slowly at first. Most didn't realize, or didn't care, and accepted them. They chose a comfortable life. Some didn't. And those who refused to conform were pushed to the sidelines. Criminalized. They became our clients. We call ourselves runners. We exist on the edge, between the gloss and the reality. The mirror's edge. We keep out of trouble, out of sight, and the cops don't bother us. Runners see the city in a different way. We see the flow. Rooftops become pathways and conduits, possibilities, and routes of escape. The flow is what keeps us running, keeps us alive.
So let's start off on a positive and talk about something Mirror's Edge does really well. One of the first things that strikes you about the game, and it's the visuals, that beautiful city, the bold, striking colours. I have a huge amount of respect for the art direction in Mirror's Edge because that city setting and the way it's been designed and brought to life, it's more than just a cool looking backdrop for a game. I think it's also exploring some really interesting ideas, and if you'll bear with me for a few minutes, I'd love to just bore the arse off you with what I think that city and the art direction represents. It's a beautiful looking city, huge buildings, a giant glass shard, the sun is shining and the sky is blue, everything's clean and safe looking, it's all quite prosperous and affluent. Ostensibly this is a utopian paradise. Also I think just that image of a city skyline itself is like an iconic symbol of capitalism and democracy, because rightly or wrongly the two are often perceived to go hand in hand. Yet as we find out in Mirror's Edge, this isn't a utopian democracy at all, it's a dystopian totalitarian regime. So straight off the bat, there's this interesting contrast between how the city appears and how it actually is. It takes that imagery of Western culture and all the meanings we associate with it, and it subverts them. I think this is clever because for an idea centred around an oppressive government with political and institutional corruption, assassinations, all that kind of dark stuff, it would have been really easy for DICE to set the game in this obvious dystopian nightmare of a city, but they've done the complete opposite. There's none of that visual shorthand you would normally expect to see in a dystopian setting, and by doing that, I think it raises some interesting questions. I think DICE are asking questions like, how far should a government go in the quest for security and safety? Is it right to sacrifice freedom of speech and a free media in order to maintain those things? Mirror's Edge is a game that probably went into production right in the middle of the Bush administration, where after 9/11 certain civil liberties were being waived under the guise of homeland security. Considering that context, I think it's quite a bold issue for a game to explore, and Mirror's Edge does it in a really clever way. And the game's setting is a really smart way of commenting on that hypocrisy, like a society which on the face of things prides itself on its image, but deep down does some very dark things to maintain that image. So if you bear all that kind of stuff in mind, I think you can start to see how clever the art direction really is, especially the use of colour. First off, serves a couple of pretty obvious purposes. One, it just looks cool, like it really does. Having such a simple but striking colour palette gives the game a really distinct visual style, the kind where you can just recognise the game from any screenshot. Someone can go, yeah, that's Mirror's Edge, because nothing else looks like that. Also has a gameplay function in runner vision, using the colour red to highlight objects of interest and to subtly guide you throughout levels, giving you a sense of direction and clues on how to approach the platforming bits without being too obvious or intrusive and interfering with the pacing or rhythm of the game. That's really clever too. But apart from all of that, the art direction serves to reinforce all those themes and ideas I was just prattling on about. Everything about the way the city is presented has these connotations which you subconsciously pick up on. Like, we already talked about the city and the skyline itself having certain connotations, but the use of colour adds further depth to these meanings. For example, the fact that everything is bathed in white is a colour which signifies a purity, a goodness. Whenever you see a depiction of God or heaven, it's always white. It evokes those kind of notions. And there's very little use of darker colours which represent the opposite ends of the spectrum, unlike, say, Dishonored or Batman Arkham City, which are overtly dystopian cities and they're all really dark and grimy. Everything being covered in white makes sense if you're trying to convey to your citizens that they're living in a paradise. Also, all the bold colours you see dotted all around the city, it all looks really simple. The colouring isn't complicated in any way, it's always single shades of colour, there's never any shading, which suggests to me the notion that everything is exactly as you see it. Everything is clear cut, black and white, there's no in between, there's no shades of grey, there's no shades at all in fact, which again kind of fits in with the idea of a city being constructed by a regime which doesn't want people questioning the things around them. And glass is also a prominent part of the city's architecture, particularly the Shard, the focal point of the city which is home to the mayor's office and all the computers which monitor the city's electronic communications. Glass has connotations of transparency, of having nothing to hide. All of this just reiterates the idea of the city as a utopia in terms of appearance, but obviously, as we know, it's in appearance only. And it's no coincidence that as the game progresses and you start to realise how bad it is, the action moves to a nighttime setting where this use of colour diminishes and we're introduced to darker settings with different connotations. This is a fantastic example of how the art direction has more than just an aesthetic function. It creates a tone. It reinforces themes explored in the plot. It's world building. I have a tremendous amount of respect for whoever was behind the art direction and the styling, the whole conceptualization of the city, as for me, it's right up there as one of the most striking and memorable and clever game settings I've ever come across. So, with such a fantastic, rich setting, ripe with potential for all kinds of interesting ideas, the game must have a pretty decent plot to do it justice, right? Well, you'd hope so, but unfortunately, it's not the case. The plot is pretty awful, to be honest, and it's a real shame as it squanders an amazing opportunity. Now, I don't necessarily think there's anything inherently wrong with the general story, like the stuff that happens in it, the framing of your sister, exposing corruption, being betrayed by someone you trusted, etc., etc., all of that stuff. I think it has a kind of neo-noir vibe to it, and while it was probably never going to rewrite the rulebook on video game storytelling, if done competently, could have been perfectly serviceable, and it definitely still had the potential to explore all those interesting themes and ideas inherent in the premise. But it didn't, and the real problem for me was with the narrative, like how that story and those characters are actually constructed and presented to us. Mirror's Edge doesn't do a very good job at establishing either the characters or the world that you inhabit. Yeah, you're told the premise in the opening cutscene, you get the gist, but a gist isn't going to make for a very immersive story, you need details. For example, we know Faith is a runner who operates outside the law, passing restricted information between clients. That's the gist. But who are her clients? What is the information that she's carrying? They're the details. You're also not told exactly to what extent free speech is prohibited. Like, is all online communication just monitored or censored or outright banned? Is it just political dissent that's suppressed? Again, you're not told, but these are the important details, because without this kind of information, we don't really know why Faith and these other runners do what they do for a living. Are they in it for the good of the people, or just for the money? So, from the get-go, you have a character you don't really know or understand. As for the plot, in the very first level, or the prologue, we're told that there's a stronger, more aggressive amount of police than normal.
It's supposed to be a low-key job. Why the hell were they shooting? What did you do with it?
Nothing.
But we don't know that, because we as gamers never know any different from that prologue. Like, we don't get an intro mission, like a job that goes really smoothly so we have an idea of what most jobs for Faith are like. We don't see that. So the shock of the situation, SWAT teams chasing and shooting you, the impact of that is entirely lost. Mirror's Edge just dives straight into things without spending any time to get you invested, and as a result, right off the bat, the gamer has barely any kind of engagement with the narrative. I think a lot of the games that are generally considered to have great immersive stories, they often spend a bit of time, even if only briefly, just introducing you into the game world before the events of the plot kick off properly, and I think that's something that Mirror's Edge would have really benefited from. Things don't get any better by the second level either, as Merc just happens to briefly mention this mayor, Pope, who's running for office and who's going to change things, literally 2 minutes before you walk in a room and find the guy dead.
You know he was running for mayor, right? Finally, someone who could actually make a difference in this place.
I mean, it's shocking exposition, it really is, but again, What's worse is that this faceless corpse on a desk is basically the trigger for the entire game's events, and you know nothing about him. You have no idea what his policies were or who he was as a person, and at this point you're not told anything about the incumbent Mayor Callahan either, so you don't know what Pope was supposedly going to be different to. It's so badly written that you don't even know if his murder was a bad thing. I mean, obviously you're supposed to automatically assume that no free speech or media is a bad thing, but if you think about it, are you ever shown a single citizen suffering or undergoing any kind of hardship in the city as a result of this regime? All you do know for sure is that this city is really clean, it's really safe and prosperous as a result of totalitarianism. Does anyone actually care that they have no civil liberties when their standard of living is so cushy? Does anyone miss them? You're not told. So for all you know, this assassination of the mayor could have been for the greater good of the people, because, I mean, he was just going to fuck everything up that had been working really well. Which I'm sure isn't the intended message, but it just goes to show how many crucial details that the entire premise relies on are just completely neglected in the plot. Oh yeah, and there's a plot to obtain information on all the runners and get rid of them for good, but since you don't even know exactly what it is they do, why they do it, who they do it for, and what the point of it is, it's really hard to give a shit. There are little snippets of world-building info to be found dotted about in the game, which give some insight into who the characters like Mayor Callahan are and what they're up to. It's normally all found in elevators, but it's just too little too late by the time you actually start to find them and read them, and it's still indicative of one of the biggest problems of the narrative, that you're told things instead of being shown them. Also, it doesn't help that the cutscenes are delivered to us in this half-assed cel-shaded style animation, which looks like shit next to the stunning gameplay visuals. I suppose I should think of something positive to say. It's nice to have a strong female protagonist who isn't overtly sexualised but at the same time hasn't been masculinised. She's a plenty capable character and she doesn't rely on anyone really to save her in a tricky situation. There's no bullshit love interest. It's just a story about someone who happens to be female and ultimately her gender's pretty inconsequential. Again, props to DICE for doing something a bit bold and different to most other games. Decent female protagonists still seem to be something of a rarity these days. It's just a shame that as a character, Faith is pretty two-dimensional and doesn't get all that much to do. So, the whole narrative is a bit of a shambles, and it's a real shame as you have this great premise which the art and design team have clearly taken on board and ran with and produced this amazing backdrop, this city rich with meaning and subtext, but it's like the scriptwriters have just churned out this woefully inept plot to go with it. It's a tragic waste of such a good concept, and I feel really sorry for all the concept artists and designers who probably put loads of thought into their work, only for it to all go largely unnoticed because of such a forgettable narrative which nobody cared about. For all intents and purposes, Faith may as well have just been some teenage delinquent getting a kick out of trespassing and pissing off the police. Despite all that though, it's not the worst thing in the world that Mirror's Edge has a shite plot. There are games out there which you might play through a second or even a third time and not skip the cutscenes because for some people the story is as enjoyable as the gameplay itself. Worst case scenario is Mirror's Edge just isn't one of those games. When you play it, you'll play it for the gameplay and you'll skip the cutscenes every time. It's a shame though because I do think a gripping story will always add weight to whatever you're doing, but at the end of the day, you can still have fun even with its crap plot. So the gameplay then, this is the divisive bit, this is the bit that people tend to either love or hate. Gameplay can basically be broken up into two parts. You've got the free running platforming sections which make up the overwhelming majority of the game and the combat which can mostly be avoided by the odd forced encounter. Let's start with the platforming. I definitely sit in a camp that believes Mirror's Edge is a really accomplished platformer. To put it simply, legging it across rooftops and jumping from one building to another, performing all these death-defying stunts is hands down some of the most fun I've had out of all the games released this gen, and I've played quite a lot of them. There's something really captivating about Mirror's Edge which is difficult to articulate and either something you get from playing or you just don't, hence I imagine its cult-like following. There's something about the way Faith feels, like the way she controls. It's really hard to describe, but it's like you actually feel like you're controlling a person, like an actual person rather than just moving a camera around. There's a weight to your body and a very real sense of gravity, like when you jump and when you fall, especially if you stack it off of a rooftop. I'm not sure how they pulled it off. Maybe it's the little details like the lack of head-up display, the fact you can see your body if you look down, and the way you catch glimpses of your hands and feet while vaulting over objects, or when Faith puts her hands up if you go to walk into a wall. There's also a sense of speed you get from sprinting, the slight head wobble from moving, or the sound effects, the grunts, the breathlessness, the footsteps. It's probably all of those things, plus other stuff I can't put my finger on, but if you said to me all those years ago that a first-person platformer could work this well, I never would have believed you, but it does. The feeling I get when approaching this huge jump and you have this instinctive knowledge of exactly when to jump right at the last second when your brain is almost telling you it's too late, you fucked it, but you don't, you make it, even though you couldn't even see the edge when you jumped because it was below your field of vision. I don't know how DICE achieved it, but they've struck gold. It's immensely rewarding, and yet it doesn't feel fluky. Like, I rarely found myself running off the edge of buildings or missing jumps. The failure, if you like, if you want to call it that, in Mirror's Edge is more often than not just performing a jump incorrectly, like doing a vault that's too slow and cumbersome, which slows you down. In terms of your abilities, you're afforded quite an arsenal of moves. Apart from just bog standard running and jumping, you can slide, curl over objects, wall climb, wall run jump, wall run turn and jump, plus all kinds of combinations of those things. All of these moves are pretty easy to perform. I had very few problems executing and stringing together combos. It's a system which is incredibly easy to pick up and learn, extremely difficult to master, and that's the way it should be. I was really surprised when I first played it just how polished and accomplished it feels, and apart from a couple of dodgy hotspots where Faith doesn't respond in a jump how you were expecting, or other moments where jumps are tricky to judge, the vast majority of the time when I died, I knew it was my fault, not the game's. So for me, the platforming was really fun and rewarding experience. I do think it's the main focus of the game, and it's probably why it's so divisive, as not everyone enjoyed it. That buzz I get from sprinting full pelt along a rooftop, jumping to an adjacent building and wall running along to reach a new area, not everyone's going to get that buzz. I appreciate that the platforming aspect isn't for everyone, for whatever reasons, so I guess at the end of the day it's just down to personal tastes. Unfortunately, there is one aspect of the gameplay that severely let Mirror's Edge down, and I think that's one that almost everyone will agree on: combat. So thankfully, combat in Mirror's Edge is generally limited to a few encounters, but even that's enough to leave a sour taste in your mouth. There are two main problems at the core of combat in Mirror's Edge, as far as I can see. The first of these problems is that the combat mechanics feel like an afterthought, like it was something tacked on at the end after they'd perfected the free-running mechanics, evident by how, apart from your bog-standard one-button attack, all your other moves have been tacked on to Faith's platforming abilities. So you've got the slide kick, the jump kick, and a wall run kick, but it's all pretty badly executed. Slide kicks and jump kicks don't even knock the enemy out in one. You still have to get up and give them a bit more of a beating, so it barely feels worth the extra effort, as it's easier to miss with those special moves than it is the basic attack. And I've yet to find a single moment in the game where you're given the opportunity to perform a wall run kick. At no point did I ever find a guard just waiting in the right position for you to do it every time. So it seems like something you'll only get to pull off if the stars perfectly align and a guard just happens to position himself near a wall with which you have time and room to execute the combo and don't fuck it up. Blind luck. Likewise, there's only one moment in the entire game where I was able to perform a stealth disarm, and it's only because the game gives it to you on a silver platter. It just makes me wonder why they bothered implementing those moves at all. Now, I respect that as a first-person game, it's never going to pull off a combat system as rewarding and with as much depth as, say, you know, the Arkham games, but that doesn't mean combat has to be downright awful. Condemned Criminal Origins was a first-person game that was heavily focused on melee combat, and it worked pretty well for its time because it was clear that a lot of effort had gone into making sure it worked in first-person. The boss fight in Chapter 7 of Mirror's Edge is a perfect example of how the game has not been designed with melee combat in mind whatsoever. It's utterly woeful. Practically all you can do is punch, and then when you punch, dare have the nerve to try and punch more than once and you will be counted every single time. You can't counter the boss's moves at all, so all you do is move sideways, punch, and repeat ad nauseum until you've given the prompt to disarm. Then repeat it all over again 5 minutes later. It's the most contrived moment in the entire game and the perfect example of how the combat has no depth and feels like an absolute afterthought. As for disarms, they can be a real pain to pull off. I'm no good at QTE type things anyway, and for me, the window of opportunity that you're given to hit Y is too short, and it's not something easily perfected either, as different guards will have different weapons which have different melee animations, and so a different timing is required to counter each one. You can press X to initiate slow motion, but I think it's a really horrible looking effect, to be honest. I get what they were going for, that John Woo style slow-mo, heightened sense of reality, but it just doesn't work for me. It's all just a bit intrusive and often interrupts the pace of the game, so it isn't a particularly fun thing to do. And when it comes to weapons, they're a bit naff too. You can't precision aim, and with a tiny aiming reticule and massive amounts of recoil, it makes aiming at any guard that isn't right in front of you pretty much redundant. All of this ties into my second major problem with the combat in Mirror's Edge. It feels like the game is purposefully dissuading you to engage in it. guns have very limited ammo and the lack of HUD means you can't tell how much is left and you can't aim down sights or zoom in. You have an extremely limited amount of health and enemies can deal massive amounts of damage to you. Even on normal, combat can become a real challenge. If you fail a disarm twice, you're dead. If there's another guard nearby shooting you, and there nearly always is, you'll only get one shot at the disarm before you're killed. It's a lot like in the old Splinter Cell games where you're almost punished for engaging enemies directly. Now, none of these features would be a bad thing. Far from it, in fact. They all make perfect design sense within the context of the game. And I wouldn't want that aspect changed. The problem is when the game forces you to participate in combat. As far as I'm concerned, these sections shouldn't even be in the game. Again, just like the old Splinter Cell, the game works best when there's always a way of avoiding, or in the case of Mirror's Edge, outrunning the enemy. Combat should be like a punishment for failure or just an optional way of playing through the game if that's how you'd prefer to. Everything about its design, your health, your lack of ammo, etc, etc, it reinforces that you shouldn't be engaging enemies directly, so it's utterly baffling to me why they implement sections of the game where you're forced to eliminate several guards in order to continue. It's not just that it goes completely against the grain of how I've been choosing to play, it's that you're so, by the nature of the game's design, so ill-equipped to deal with them all efficiently that it ends up only serving to highlight everything that's wrong with the combat and just makes me resent those sections of the game, especially if you're playing on hard. I think what would have been really good, and I really think DICE missed the trick here, is rubber bullets. If guards fired rubber bullets that hurt you and ultimately knocked you down instead of killing you, that would have made more sense to me. Maybe after knocking you down they could come over and begin handcuffing you and you would have one last chance to pull off a counter prompt and break free and escape. I think being arrested would have made for a better failure state than death, at least for the first half of the game. I guess this is another failure of the story to explain things, but I always found it a bit extreme that the police were trying to kill you dead instead of just trying to arrest you, especially in that prologue where you haven't even been implicated in the death of the mayor yet. Why is Faith that dangerous at that point in the game? What is she carrying? Firing rubber bullets, at least for the first half of the game, would have been better and live ammunition could have been introduced later on as you find out the true extent of the corruption and the police want to prevent you from exposing it. This would have made more sense in terms of story and it would have given the gameplay a nice dynamic. It would have ramped up the stakes and the tension as that shoot to kill threat would replace the safety net of having a chance to escape during arrest. There's also moments like running in a straight line towards a guard that's firing a pistol at you or climbing a ladder whilst being hit repeatedly with a shotgun that are so daft and unrealistic it can be a bit immersion breaking. So apart from the odd spot of combat, in terms of gameplay it's pretty much a one trick pony. It's all about the free running, but personally, I think it's accomplished enough and certainly enjoyable enough to carry the game, which I guess it does. So let's talk about the level design. For a game predominantly about free running, something usually perceived as an outdoor pursuit, there's a fair amount of indoor platforming in Mirror's Edge. While these sections for me were never quite as exhilarating as the outdoor rooftop sections, I do think they're essential in keeping things varied. Jumping from building to building never gets old, and I think that's because the levels are carefully balanced so there isn't too much of either indoors or outdoors. The indoor sections make a nice contrast to the outdoors. They're more claustrophobic, things are slowed down a tad. Often they're a bit more exploratory and less reliant on chase sequences. There is a sense of freedom and control, a sense of power that you get when you're out in the open, and I think a part of what helps achieve that is juxtaposing those moments with the trapped feeling of being like a rat in a maze when running away from guards indoors. I think DICE did a decent job in making sure the game's design doesn't get too repetitive by ensuring that there's a bit of variety in the level designs. Pretty much every chapter in the game is punctuated with sections that look and feel quite distinctive compared to other sections you're going to come across. You've got the underground sewers section with the snipers, the subway bit with the trains, the cargo ship, the shard in the final chapter. Even a lot of the rooftops and corridor sections are punctuated with unique moments you won't often see again. Colour also plays an important role in keeping things varied visually. Most of the chapters tend to have a colour palette where everything is geared slightly more in favour of one particular colour. So while you are essentially most of the time confined to rooftops or corridors, clever level design and use of colour means the locations never get too repetitive or samey. It always feels fresh and each level has its own sense of character. There's also lots of nice little details and graphical touches which make the levels feel like a real city rather than just a well-constructed set designed for platforming. There's your eyes adjusting to the light when you burst through a door to the outside, the smoke billowing out of rooftops, birds in the sky, solar panels which the cops shoot holes through, and bikes sitting outside apartments, the cars and people you can see moving below you when you look down off the edge of a building. They're all really nice touches which help bring the city to life. Now, I wouldn't go as far as to say the game has any puzzle sections, but there are certainly moments, at least on the first playthrough, where you need to stop and think about where you're going and how to get there. There's a sort of built-in hint system. I played the Xbox version here, where a simple press of the B button will face you directly at wherever you need to be going. This works kind of well indoors when you're stuck or you can't quite be bothered to waste time exploring. It will point you straight at the exit, but not necessarily at the point where you begin your climb, so you might still have to use your noggin. Outdoors doesn't work so well though, because due to the size and nature of the rooftop sections, you're never headed in one direction for any prolonged period of time, so the B button will instead direct you in the general direction that you need to go next, usually a nearby building. The problem is that the B button doesn't move the camera, it moves your entire body, and you rarely reach objectives by heading as the crow flies. You need to climb up adjacent buildings which aren't necessarily in the same direction as where the B button is pointing you. So what can happen is you find yourself being chased across the rooftop, the fuzz are right behind you, you're running for your life, and you press B to see what direction you should be heading, and it will forcibly move your entire body in a completely different direction. It can stop you dead in your tracks and completely destroy your momentum and break the immersion. What would have made a lot more sense is if the B button simply turned your head towards where you need to go, but you retain control of your body. This would mean it would be up to the player to choose carefully when to use the B button. If you found yourself running into walls because of it, it would be your own fault as you literally weren't looking where you're going. A good example is GTA 5. Sometimes when driving, you can press a button to toggle focus on something else that you're following, and it affects the camera, but not the direction of the car, which you still have full control over. Something like that in Mirror's Edge would have been a lot better. The only other real problem I had with the level design is that the chapters are pretty linear. There are occasions where you have a choice of different ways in which to reach a destination, and there is nearly always multiple ways of exploiting your abilities and combos to reach the same spot. But ultimately, the destination's always the same. Alternate paths throughout a level are something the game is sorely lacking in my opinion. Also, the other big gripe is the elevator scenes, load screens in disguise. They normally pop up at least once or twice in a level, sometimes take absolutely ages, and for a game that's so much about momentum, they can really interrupt and ruin the experience. I guess it was the limitations of the tech at the time though, so I'm not entirely unforgiving, but it is still annoying. It will be interesting to see how loading's going to work in an open world sequel, which I imagine players would expect to be even more expansive than the original. I heard a few complaints that Mirror's Edge was too short. Well, yeah, the main game isn't especially long, nor is it particularly difficult, so most people will probably breeze through it pretty swiftly. You can't really criticise people for rushing through it and not taking their time to enjoy the sights the way you can some games, as that's just not the nature of Mirror's Edge. The whole point is to sprint through the thing as fast as you can. There are hidden packages scattered throughout the levels, which if you're into that sort of thing might encourage another playthrough, but in my mind it's just a complete contradiction to everything the game is about, stopping and wandering around in an area looking for hidden objects while you're being chased by cops and shot at by a police helicopter. Makes no sense at all to me. I still fucking did it, mind, don't get me wrong, it's just daft. Where Mirror's Edge comes alive and where the real longevity is to be found is in the speedruns and time trials. The game is naturally geared towards speed, so working out the fastest path through a level, finding the best route, perfecting the right combos, and then executing that perfect run, it requires patience, skill, and practice, but when you pull it off, it's really rewarding. The speedruns for each chapter aren't too demanding, there's plenty of room for mistakes, but the time trials are crushing. Obtaining 3 stars on a time trial requires absolute perfection, maximum speed and efficiency, and generally zero room for mistakes. It's a genuine challenge, and it's not something you can easily polish off in an afternoon, especially if you have the DLC, which is even more brutal. To be honest, I'd like to show you some footage of me bossing a time trial stage, but the truth is, it's been so long since I did them, I'm just absolutely shit at it now. You can see me racing against my ghost here though, and I can barely keep up with myself, but that's another fantastic thing about the time trials. You're able to race against ghosts, either your own, your friends, or absolutely anyone on the leaderboards. Having trouble working out how to achieve a 3-star time? Simply load up a ghost from someone with a 3-star time and follow them, see what route they use and what combos they do. The game even leaves red footprints on the surfaces so you can track the ghost even if you balls it up and lose sight of them. And there's a timer telling you if you're up or down on their time. It's a brilliantly executed game mode with some great features, and if you like a challenge, it's a lot of fun. I mean, yeah, it's the kind of fun where you'll scream at your TV and you want to smash your controller against the wall, but when you beat it, if you beat it, it's so immensely satisfying and you'll look back and think, yeah, that was fun, even though it didn't feel like it at the time. So that's pretty much the highs and lows of Mirror's Edge then, that I can think of anyway. The game attempted to do something different, something that, as far as I'm aware, had never been done before, and it not only pulled it off, it pulled it off with a real panache, and that's something increasingly rare in games these days. So, does it deserve to be hailed as one of the great unsung triumphs of the last generation? Well, unfortunately, there's no definitive answer to that. It's always going to be a matter of opinion. For some people, absolutely not, and fair enough. But for me, yeah, I really, really love it, and I definitely think it's an overlooked game. It certainly has its flaws, but I can easily forgive them, because what Mirror's Edge does well, it does really well. And when it's good, it's really good. And that soundtrack, Still Alive by Lisa Mikovsky, perfectly encapsulates every feeling, every emotion, every tone that Mirror's Edge as a game sets out to evoke in the player. I'm not articulate enough to put it into words, I just know that as soon as I hear that song, I'm reminded of every single thing I love about the game, and it just makes me want to play it again. I guess on that note, as the credits roll and that song plays, you'll know upon hearing it which side of the fence you sit on in regards to whether Mirror's Edge is a failure or a triumph. So thanks for watching, I hope you've enjoyed it. Let me know what you thought in the comments. If you agreed with what I said, or if you didn't agree, let me know, just in the nicest way possible. If you want to hit the like button too, that would be super. And also be sure to subscribe for more in-depth reviews coming soon. I'm also going to be working on a video talking about Mirror's Edge 2, stuff which I'd like to see, stuff I don't want to see, discussing how that transition to an open world is going to affect things. So you never know, it could end up becoming like an open letter to DICE. So if you have any ideas of stuff you'd like to see in a sequel, go ahead and follow me on Twitter, @Thinreaper, I'll put a little link up on the screen there, and let me know what you'd like to see or not see, and I'll factor in your responses when making the video. So yeah, that's all for now, thanks for watching.